here in Northeast Ohio back in 1803. James and Danny Heaton found the ore that was lying in Yellow Creek. They built a blast furnace there along the shore, and they made the cannonballs that helped the Union win the war.
Youngstown, Ohio is a city with a sad history. The day known as Black Monday, or September 19th, 1977, was a dark day. The closure of Youngstown's sheet and tube on Black Monday cost 5,000 workers their jobs, and more closures were coming in the years following. The population gradually fled the city for the suburbs and any other area where they could find jobs. Today we will explore Black Monday itself, the reasons why people left Youngstown, and where they chose to settle after leaving. To fully understand Black Monday, we have to look at the Likes Corporation's purchase of Youngstown Sheet and Tube. Likes bought Sheet and Tube in 1969, and that purchase marked the first time that industrial decisions would be made outside of the city. Likes decided to move Sheet and Tube's headquarters from the Campbell Works to Indiana in 1977. The Campbell Works was shut down on Black Monday, and it was a traumatic time for the city. 5,000 workers lost their jobs, and the loss of the Campbell Works started a chain reaction of mill closures leading up to 1985.
I find it funny what you can recollect and what you can remember from a young age. I have a lot of very vivid memories of the steel mills themselves. We grew up right above them, just up on the hill on the south side of the river. My grandparents lived just across the river and up the hill on the north side, and so we would pass through them all the time, and we knew they were there. You saw all the action going on. My brother and I used to love passing over the Black Bridge on Shirley Road. There was right in the middle of the bridge, there was a big part where periodically you'd see a big shot of flame come up if they were pouring something and all that. And it, you know, as little kids, that was just a neat thing to see all the time. We would get upset if we crossed the bridge and all that there was no flame this time or whatever. And so my memories of the mills themselves are you know, it was a very strong presence in our childhood. And to see them closing, as you know, when Black Monday came around in 77, I was only about 5 years old, going on six, so I was pretty young. I don't really remember really getting the news. I didn't really understand what was going on or know what was going on, but parents were talking about it. I mean, it was the talk of the town. It was Sheet and Tube that announced first on Black Monday that they were moving, I think, to Indiana. And about 5,000 people were going to lose their jobs. And it was a huge setback in the sense that everyone wondered. I mean, you have 5,000 people, that probably meant, you know, if most of them were married, that's 10,000 people, and if half of them had two or three kids, that's 20 to 25,000 people that now no longer have an income, and it was devastating.
Well, I probably would have been about 8 years old then, so probably a second grader at St. Ed's grade school, and I think the clearest thing that I remember, and I've talked about this before, is that I think around Christmas time of that year, my parents told me that, you know, a lot of my friends might not have a great Christmas because their father had lost their job at one of the local mills, or a grandfather had. And before that, I'm not really quite sure if I paid that much attention to it, especially being an 8 year old. But that's about the first thing that I recollect about that whole series of events in 77 and then 78. And I was thinking this morning, even in 10 years later in 1987 when I graduated from high school here in Youngstown, you still had a lot of the hulking presence of the mills along the river, but you knew that there wasn't really anybody working there anymore. And I think, you know, that at that point in time, probably in the mid-70s, our population was probably somewhere around 125,000. And then when I came back to Youngstown at one point in time in 98, our population was down to 95,000. And now in 2017, it's 65,000 people. So I think the closure of the mills was really the first kick in the gut to Youngstown. And it's something we're still trying to recover from.
Black Monday was really the beginning of the end of the basic steel industry here in the Mahoning Valley. And over the next 3.5 years, the whole process just continued like a snowball going down the hill. And we lost the Briar Hill Works on the northwest side of Youngstown. U.S. Steel closed the Ohio Works and the McDonald Works. And then, almost ironically, about 2.5-3 weeks after I graduated from high school in 1981, Republic Steel Corporation closed the last of their basic operations in Youngstown. And so the industry was gone. And through that process, in that time of my life, coming to age, it really changed attitudes around here, and it changed our student body at Bourbon High School, because in my class, I can think of maybe 20 to 24 kids that I had known through elementary and middle school who just disappeared after our freshman year or during our freshman year, and most likely their fathers worked either in an upper skilled job or in management and were transferred out of town, so these kids went away. At the same time, we had other young people that came into our class who had started out at Cardinal Mooney High School, and either because their parents lost their jobs and they couldn't afford the tuition anymore, or I think the diocese had put a significant tuition hike in effect that year, they transferred to Boardman. And so that really defined that period of my life, but also the whole community in terms of where we've been in the last 40 years.
Youngstown's population dropped by over 50% from 1980 to 2000. The drastic decrease in population was directly tied to the crushed economic system. The high unemployment was the most obvious push factor for people to leave, but there were others as well. In a psychological study conducted by Terry Buss, Richard Hofstetter, and F. Stevens Redburn, it was determined that former mill workers were feeling three levels of alienation after the closure. They described these three dimensions of alienation as powerlessness, cynicism, and enemy. This multi-tiered alienation could have been a push factor for many, seeing as they no longer felt a sense of purpose without the mills. Another push factor would be the rapid shrinkage that Youngstown experienced almost immediately after the mills started to close. All the former infrastructure became useless and cluttered the city, and the outer areas began to have huge increases in crime. To avoid the shrinkage in crime, people fled the city.
Obviously it affected everybody. You know, people lost their jobs, many people had to move. We probably didn't really see it happen right away. I'm sure there was this exodus that took place right away of the people that lost their jobs and maybe found an opportunity somewhere else. But it really was the start of a long 10 to 15 year decline of the population that really is just so noticeable in any little local stat that you want to look at. If you think of at the time of Black Monday in the 70s, the city of Youngstown, forget the suburbs for a moment, just within the city itself, there were six high schools, all of which, obviously they weren't all the same size. North was pretty small, but Rayon was of mediocre size, but Cheney, South, Wilson, East, all huge high schools graduating 600, 700 kids a year each. It was a huge population. And that was still going at the time of Black Monday. Gradually, enough people move out that by 79, 80, North High School closes. We're down to five. probably not a huge hit, but it didn't stop there. We joke about it because my uncle was my uncle taught in the city. He was a teacher in Youngstown City Schools, and he also coached basketball. And the running joke in the family was that every school he went to, that was the next school that closed. He ended up coaching at every school except for Rayen at some point in time in his career, because everywhere he went, that was the next school that ended up closing. You have North closing in 80-81. Not long after, it took a little while, but East was gone. South closed, then Wilson. Cheney became sort of a technical school, sort of the city's own JVS school. Rayen closes. All of this took time. It took place over the course of the 80s into the early to mid 90s. It took about 15 years, but it started with Black Monday. It started with this huge loss of jobs, people moving away, the labor force having to go somewhere else looking for jobs, people being forced to move elsewhere, and it also affected the suburbs.
Yeah, I mean, if you have a population, say, of 125,000 people, you know, originally, let's see, probably about mid-50s, early 60s, our population was 165,000. As I said, we're down to 65,000 now. We're basically a third of the city, population-wise, that we used to be. But the physical boundaries of the city haven't changed. You still have 1,100 lane miles of roadway that has to be resurfaced and plowed and salted and taken care of on a daily basis. You've got about 750 miles of water lines and then the corresponding amount of sewer lines underneath the ground that still have to be maintained. You have the physical boundaries of a community that have to be patrolled by your police department and by your fire department. So even though, for example, we've reduced the number of firehouses in the city and we've probably cut our police department in half since the 70s, I think in the mid-80s we had 1,700 city employees overall. We're down to 700 now. So the loss in population that's occurred over the last 40-45 years has basically cut government in half. But the responsibilities we have are still the same. We have to, when you lose all those folks, you have a huge amount of empty houses that are left behind. So over the last 3 years, we've taken down 1,100 vacant properties and commercial structures. Probably in the last 8 years, we've taken about 3,100 properties down. We're hoping to take 550 homes down just this year alone. We've dedicated some extra resources to it. So with that resulting loss in population, you really are sort of deconstructing the city almost year by year. On our far east side, we basically shut off 4 miles of roadway last fall and barricaded them. There were residential streets where we used to have a whole bunch of residents, but there's nothing left there anymore. Most of the homes had been torn down, or if not, we tore them down last year. But it had become a huge dumping ground. Tires by the hundreds, just garbage, construction debris, two boats that were basically just dropped off in what was left of an old residential community. So we were able to, that was pretty much a largely unused portion of the city at this point in time, and we basically just blocked it off. We're closing off water lines, closing off sewer lines. First Energy is going to turn off, street lights that are over there to save them some resources. And, you may see that happen in other parts of the city as we are able to either take more properties down or basically clear out a smaller residential area.
If you look at the city's population trends over the last 90 years, the city of Youngstown reached the peak of population in 1930 when there was 170,000 people living here. And it stayed up on that plateau between 165 and 170,000 population through the 30s, 40s, and 50s, and was still about 165,000 in 1960. And then from there to 1970, you begin to see a decline in the city's population. And then after 1970, it really accelerated. And so at this point, we've probably 62,000 people. So over 50 years, you lose 100,000 people that used to live in the city, that they're gone. And in the wake of that, you have abandoned businesses, you have abandoned homes, you have disrepair because the tax base shrunk along with the population. You have efforts to stabilize neighborhoods, to rebuild in areas like downtown Youngstown and a few other locations in the city. You had mayoral administrations since then trying through whatever economic development tools they had to add to the tax base through income tax by creating jobs within the city. But we just can't keep up with a population loss that big.
The people of Youngstown did not roll over after the mills closed. They fought back. Many petitioned the Likes Corporation to reopen the Camel Works, and when that failed, they directly petitioned the government. However, this attempt also failed. The people then gave it one last-ditch effort to get the mill back open. They raised money. A clergy-led group began taking donations from the public, and they tried on numerous occasions to purchase the mill from the Likes Corporation. Unfortunately, this attempt also failed, but Youngstown has not disappeared like some other former steel towns. The spirit of the city remains strong, even to this day, as people continue efforts to revive the city.
I'd say this community survived because A, people were tough, but B, you had very strong networks within the larger community where people were able to support each other through hard times. And this really started during the Great Depression 85, 90 years ago, where people thrown out of work had to rely on family, friends, the church, local charities to get by until they could be reemployed. And it was the same impact in terms of the number of lost jobs, the spiritual and social devastation, where you just have a whole industry and a whole way of life disappear in a short period of time. And so those who were thrown out of work, including a lot of men and some women in their 30s and 40s that still had a lot of time left to put in to the job market before they can even think about retiring, that they had to rely on family and church and social organizations and their extended families in their communities to get by. If the steel companies can't or don't want to run these mills anymore, why can't we create a local operation, community worker ownership, where the community basically owns one or more of the mills and modernizes them and provides jobs and creates products that are competitive in the market? And that had a really big push in 1978, 1979, to the point that you organized the Ecumenical Coalition, which was headed by religious leaders, but also political elected public officials and business people, and some of these folks that were coming in and talking about this new model of worker community ownership, got to the point where we were applying for federal grants and loan guarantees to cover the hundreds of millions of dollars it would cost to modernize and reopen any one of these mills. And unfortunately, that's as far as it went, because the government would not provide the grants or even the loan guarantees to make that happen. So it gradually petered out. There was some resistance from some companies like U.S. Steel Corporation about worker community ownership, because they didn't want to compete with publicly subsidized steel companies or mills. That's not what they were about, and they resisted to the point where they wouldn't even think of a purchase offer or selling the property to anyone local to do that.
After the exodus from the city, people settled in new places for different reasons. The most common places to settle were the suburbs and towns surrounding Youngstown, such as Boardman, Austintown, Canfield, and Poland. Youngstown has a rich history of family pride, so staying close to Youngstown allowed people to remain close to their familial history. This major pull factor influenced many, but there were a lot of people who left the area completely. These people were pulled to areas with car plants and other industrial labor sites, such as Lordstown, Ohio, and New Stanton, Pennsylvania. The pull of a new job was great for many former mill workers, as they could continue the work they had done in Youngstown.
I was supposed to go to the local neighborhood elementary school. I started school in the fall of 77. I have memories of going to Adams Elementary School, right up the street. I had to walk 10 houses to get there. Went to orientation, met my teacher. Like 2 days before school's supposed to start, my parents get a call that they're closing Adams Elementary. I would now be going to McGuffey, I think, which is like on the east side of Youngstown. I was supposed to walk to the other end of the street, catch a WRTA bus to the bottom of the hill, and then a school bus would pick me up there and take me to, you know, halfway across town.
Well, Lordstown Assembly Plant and General Motors really, along with the local healthcare industry, has taken over the leadership in terms of commerce and industry and economic development and creating and maintaining jobs from what used to be the steel industry. The plant opened in 1965, and it was very large, modern assembly plant, and it has survived all these years and several model changeovers. You had in the 60s and 70s a more tense, often negative relationship between the workers and the United Auto Workers Union and the management of the company, frequent what you would call wildcat strikes, where not authorized by the national or international union, but still there were grievances and workers would walk off the line. And that began to change in the 1980s because the union leadership and the management said to each other, if we don't do this differently, they're gonna shut us down. And again, that would have regional impact because you have the thousands of jobs that are there, plus you have as many, if not more, jobs in related industries that are dependent upon Lordstown as far as supplying parts for cars, but also providing maintenance, mechanical systems, all the things that go toward running a major assembly line like you have out in Lordstown. So as long as Lordstown is operating and providing jobs, though it's a fraction of the number of jobs that were there 40 years ago. I mean, you had more than 12,000 people employed at Lordstown, and now it's probably about a little less than 3,000, I would imagine. And they recently shut down the third shift, or only operating two shifts out of the day, and about 1,200 people were affected by that. So it's still there. It's a major regional economic player, but we have to keep our eyes on the future in terms of that particular industry.
So your city, as it's kind of standard across America, is left with your lower class, poorer working people. It was time to get out. If you didn't want to be in that environment, you better go now. And so my parents did. We moved to Boardman. And even then, you can see how it started to affect the suburbs in terms of the population. People started to move away. Probably some of the people that were in management work. Again, all of the subsidiary jobs that worked off of the steel mills that there was now no longer use for. If Lordstown doesn't come in, coincidentally, if the GM plant at Lordstown doesn't come in just before Black Monday, where do any of these people get jobs? I mean, and that's why the town gets so nervous every time they hear that GM might be making cuts. Because could we survive another Black Monday? If we lose Lordstown, what's left here in terms of manufacturing? We really have moved into a service economy. Everybody that works here works in some sort of professional or service industry. And we get by doing that, but you know, we moved out, and you can see the population, even in the suburbs, moving out.
Despite its sad history, Youngstown has not vanished. Youngstown is still here. It is no longer an example of industrial wealth, but now a symbol of hope for the Rust Belt, the Steel Valley, and all other areas that have experienced deindustrialization. The fight in the people and their spirit have saved Youngstown from becoming a ghost town, and these people will not give up their fight anytime soon.
Younger people in their teens, 20s, and 30s have no reference whatsoever to what the steel industry was like or what it was like to be part of a family that was employed in and dependent upon the steel industry for their livelihood. People hear stories from their parents and grandparents, but it doesn't really help to truly appreciate it. Of course, you have museums, including one that's dedicated to the history of our local industry, and other historical organizations that try to preserve and retell those stories and put it into historic context, but still, I've found that younger people yearn to understand that, but they can never really appreciate it. But we'll do the best we can as far as telling those stories and why it's important to today.
Nobody in Youngstown has ever given up because of our financial struggles. Over the past, 5 to 10 years, I think our downtown has improved greatly. We've got 3 to 4 residential apartment buildings, which we'd never had before. Our Federal Square has been opened up from sort of a bricked-off plaza area into vital and energetic streets in the evenings. You know, we still have Mill Creek Park, which is the second or third largest municipal park system in the country. The city won't ever give up. We still have a lot of good things going for it. But, you know, you have one step forward, maybe two steps back, or two steps forward and one step back. And the nation's financial high and lows don't really affect us that much. I mean, we're sort of ups and downs of smaller valleys, and when the nation does really well, we just go up a little bit, and if the nation starts to go down badly, we just go down a little bit. And so, you know, we're used to the struggles, quite frankly, pretty much. Let's see, I'm 47, so for 40 of those 47 years, it's generally been in a city that is in a fight, and that will continue, but I don't expect the city and its residents to give up.
Some people have held on to a belief that someday the mills would start up again because the country and the world would need and have a demand for the steel that we used to make, and part of that process was because when the company shut down, they just left their mill buildings and furnaces and everything sitting there to basically rust, but also to remind people of what was. And some people, especially some public officials and business leaders, said, well, we need to clean that up. We need to take down these old mills and start over and make that land available for new development, which I think is a good point. From my perspective as a historian who is really focused on our region's history and being an advocate of historic preservation, I wish we could have saved some elements of that steel industry, either in ruins or something that could have been rehabbed, so people could really get a sense of the scale of the industry and how big and intimidating it was to see these 100-foot-high blast furnaces and these huge shed buildings where all the furnaces and mills were in and operating in that just went up and down the Mahoning River. So it's been a long grieving process to get beyond steel, and it's taken a couple of generations to do that.
Okay, we lost the mills, that's okay. We've been given the bad work before. We've been given the devil's work before. We'll keep doing it. We'll be here. We will continue.
Youngstown, Ohio, born and bred general. Fuel my career and I ain't even at the pinnacle. We could take it back to the outdoor park days when niggas wore afros rocking the barcades. I'm trying to bring my city back to a true self. Steel town, love, happiness, and wealth. I'm praying for peace. We got a long way to go. But no matter the condition, I love to yell. Let's go.